So we're going to be in page four here on as we go through. I got to remember not to move so much because of the video now. It's like trying to preach without using your hands. You know, you almost just, it's like the spirit is not moving if I can't use my hands here a little bit. So just to catch us up a little bit here from last week, you know, we were going through this idea of four main events that took place and four main characters. And so I want to pick up on, I talked about the fall last week. We kind of ended with that and the things that were happening with the curse that God was bringing into that situation there. Today, we want to talk about the issue with the flood. And once again, we're just doing overview, so I'm just hitting the highlights of these stories and moving on so you know what's going on. None of these classes are meant to go into detail on this because we would never get through the Bible in any real length of time. So you can study some of this stuff on your own, but I just want us to know really kind of what's going on. When we talk about the flood issue, the reason for the flood in chapter 6 of Genesis is because of man's thoughts. It talks about that man's thoughts were evil all the time. And it's interesting that only just a few generations from creation, we start to get where the progression of sin that takes place, and you can see that with when it says like what is it, two or three, four generations, like something like that, that Lamech took for himself two wives. I mean, it's just a few generations, and now he's already destroying the one man, one woman relationship that God had established. And you can see this progression of sin. So in the midst of all that, one of the neat things about the scripture there, and I put down the key verse in Genesis 6, but where it says, but Noah found favor in the eyes of God, that one man found favor in the eyes of God. Great sermon. I've heard great sermons preached on that, all the bad that's going on, but there was still someone that God found favor in, and that idea of sort of hanging on in the midst of dark times. So because of the sin that's going on, right? You know, God tells Noah to build the ark, and he gives him all the dimensions and all those kind of things there. Then he sends, he has them go into the ark after they gather the animals. We know that story. And then the 40 days and nights of the raining and the flood, and it talks about that the wells of the deep burst forth. And so the rain, so you have rain coming down, you have wells that are bursting forth, and water just flowing everywhere. Eight are saved in the ark, right? Noah, his wife, their three sons, and their wives. That's all that God is going to start off with again. Then we come into this issue of the four men that we talked about. So we have creation, fall, flood, nation is the next major event that takes place. And that's where we're going to deal with primarily four major characters in the book of Genesis. Obviously, we're dealing with Abraham. Basically, Genesis chapters 12 through 23. The thing about Abraham, we know he was called from the city of Ur. Ur of the Chaldeans. Chaldeans was a people group, a pagan group. And so here Abram comes out. And the thing that's interesting about Abram is Abram's really just a pagan like anybody else. He comes from a pagan culture, but Abraham chooses to believe and put his trust in the one true God, and God then develops out of Abraham this this great nation. So one thing I like about Abraham is Abraham's not this man of great faith to start out with, not as I see him. He is a man of growing faith because there are things that Abraham does that shows that he doesn't really have this faith that we see at the end of Abraham's life at the beginning. He lies about his wife twice, you know. And so there's things about him that are, you know, and he doesn't trust in God. That's why we get into the problem with Hagar, his handmaiden, and Isaac, and those different things there. But there's good things about him, but he trusts and puts his faith and belief in God, in Yahweh. And that's the only God that he sees as being the real God. So he comes out of a pagan culture. And you see that influence still within his family. You see it with Lot and the idols that are going on in there. And we're going to see that on down through, like, still carrying over into, like, Laban with his idol that Rachel will steal. And you might know that story where she steals the household idol that all of that kind of goes on there. But he trusts in God. God promises him a couple of things, promises to make Abram into a great nation. promises him that he's going to be blessed by God, promising him that he's going to make his name great, promising him that his seed would bless all nations. Through Abram's seed, all nations will be blessed. And he talks about the promised son. So, and Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 is a key verse there, right? The Lord said to Abraham, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you, and I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So, wonderful promise that comes through Abraham. And then there's other things that happen in his life. I mean, the covenant that he makes with God, and the smoking lamp that comes between them, and the splitting up of the animal sacrifices, and the mark of circumcision that is given to Abraham that will be passed down through the Israelite nation. And all those wonderful things happen to him. We come then to Isaac, and the only thing that's really important about Isaac is that Isaac is the fulfillment of the promised child that God said he was going to have. There's not a whole lot about Isaac's life. It's more what the position that Isaac is, because God says he's going to be the promised child. So you know that Abraham has a son with Hagar, Sarai's handmaiden. That son is Ishmael. So, you know, Abram loves Ishmael. There's a lot of stuff that kind of happens once Isaac comes along, and now Sarah's upset, and she doesn't want that child and that woman to be in the inheritance. My child is the real child, because Sarah is the true wife. She's the primary wife. This is not the handmaiden kind of situation here. And so then there's some little cat fightings. There's some Old Testament cat fighting that kind of takes place there. And you know that Hagar and Ishmael are driven away, and they go and they go down near Egypt, which is interesting, and that's going to come back to have an effect in the life of Abraham's descendants later on. So he receives Rebekah as his wife. Abraham's servant goes, and there's that wonderful story where he's praying to God, let me find the woman who will come out and give me water and water my camels. I'm going to know that's the lady. And so Rebekah's the one who comes and does that, and she's willing to water the camels, which drink a lot of water and that sort of thing. And so he took it as a sign from God that this is the one that God has provided for him. And so they are married. He fathers two children, right? Esau and Jacob. And so Esau's born first. Jacob is their twins. Esau's born first. Then Jacob comes along, and Jacob is grasping the heel of his older brother, which is where his name comes from. One that grasps the heel, or one that trips someone up by the heel, is that idea there because of their birth. And you know that Isaac is tricked then later on by Rebekah, because there's you can see favoritism all through these early stories. And if any parent that's had more than one sibling knows how this can play out, if you show any kind of favoritism to one or another, even if you're not showing favoritism, there's probably a child that's saying, oh, you like them more than me, and that sort of thing there. And it always turns out bad, right? It always turns out bad. If you're the one that's the favored child, it turns out bad because the other siblings are against you. You know, if you're not the favored child, you're upset because you feel like you're being, you know, getting the short end of the stick. My brother, my older brother Jim, I'm the youngest of the three of us, and my older brother Jim was clearly the favorite in our family. And especially, I think, when it came to my grandmother. And so she would always dote on him a little bit more than the rest of us, than Ron or myself. And Ron and I got so fed up with it. We were just tired of how it was. And we just kind of banded together. And we got real mad at my brother. And he's like, well, what do you want me to do? We're like, well, you need to be mean to Grandma. That's what you need to do. So we were cleaning out Grandma's leaves in the gutter there. And we told him, now when she comes out through the garage door, the back door of the garage, you brush off all those nasty rotten leaves on Grandma's head, and you're back in good with us, okay? So when my grandmother came out, we're like, and he brushed off all those leaves on there, and She was a sergeant in the army, so she said some ungodly things to us at that moment there. But Jim was back in the fold with me and Ron, you know, because he was mean to Grandma. He's back. We leveled the playing field there. So anyway, so favoritism's not good. So Rebecca plays favoritism with Jacob. She likes the younger boy for whatever reason. The Bible talks a little bit where Jacob is more like Jacob is more like her, doing things around the house, mama's boy kind of thing. Esau's like the outdoor man. He's out there hunting and doing all that kind of stuff, and more like Isaac. And so you can see in the story this gravitation to one parent over the next. But Rebecca will trick her husband Isaac into helping her and giving the blessing to Jacob. So you know, I'm going to talk a little bit about Jacob in a moment about that story there. But in Genesis 22 verse 12 it says, "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said, "and do not do anything to him, now that I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." That is God speaking about Isaac. The story, John preached on it several months ago, right? My son John did. And he did all that so he could tell that one joke in there that Abraham, well, he's about as old as my dad, and I'm about as old as Isaac. I mean, I wanted him to do a whole different sermon, but he did that just so he could say that one joke, you know? So that's how John picks his sermon. What joke can I tell on my dad? And but there's that wonderful story there, right? Of he's going to be sacrificed, and Abraham gets ready to do that. God calls to him and says, "Hey, don't do this." Provides the ram in the thicket, and that's a foreshadowing of Jesus. Only God's going to go all the way, and he's going to lay his son on the altar of the cross of Calvary and sacrifice his son. So then that brings us to, so we have Abraham, Isaac. Then that brings us to the character of Jacob. So Jacob has the older brother. We already mentioned that. He's the younger of the twins born to Rebekah. He cheats. He first cheats his brother out of a birthright. And that's kind of that idea where the firstborn son would get a double inheritance, a double portion of the inheritance. They were to carry on sort of like the family business. They would be the patriarch of the family and kind of keep everything going. There was a certain amount of responsibility that just by culture was given to the older son. And Esau kind of despised it, says he despised his birthright because he didn't see that as something real valuable, and he sells it for a bowl of chili, right? Some lentil soup, the Bible says, you know, some stew there. He comes back, he's all famished, and Jacob has he's been watching, some cooking show or whatever, and he made some good stew. And so here, Esau comes, and Jacob says, "Sell me your birthright, and you can have some of this stew." And he says, "Okay, I'll do it." And then time goes by. Then there's the blessing that comes. And this is almost like, I mean, it's just a prayer, really, that the father has, asking for God's protection and care and providence. And I hate to use the word blessing in that, but a blessing on the son that God's going to do something great in their life. Now, I don't understand why this can't be given to every child, but Isaac says, I've given this to the one son. And so what Rebecca does then is Isaac says, you know, "I want some food." And Esau goes out to go hunt some food and game and stuff for him. And while he's gone, then Rebecca, she connives with Jacob, and they put the goat skin on him because Esau's a real hairy guy, and Jacob, I guess, is not. And so he comes in there, and they try to trick Isaac with that. And he hears Jacob's voice, so he goes, "Hey, you sound like Jacob," but he touches his hand, and he goes, "But you feel like Esau, and you smell like Esau, and so you must be Esau." And he gives him this blessing, but the blessing really was intended for Esau, but now it's given to Jacob. Well, when Isaac finds out about it, of course, he's angry. When Esau finds out about it, he's angry and goes to dad and says, "Give me something too." And basically, Isaac says, I got nothing else to say. And so then Esau basically is angry, and he's going to kill his brother Jacob. So now Jacob has to flee. He has to flee to Uncle Laban's. So he runs off and flees with them. When he goes over there, you know, he finds Rachel, one of Laban's daughters has Rachel and Leah. And the Bible talks about it that, like, Leah, she's... I mean, I hate to say it like this, but the Bible's basically saying Leah's the ugly duckling of the two, because it says she had the weak eyes, so she must not have had the Betty Davis eyes, you know what I'm saying? I don't know what her eyes look like. I don't know if they were cross-eyed. I don't know if she's looking over like this, like Hacksaw Jim Duggan, oh, whatever it was. She didn't have the eyes that said, hey, that's the girl I want. So he falls in love with Rachel. And so then the deal is struck. He's going to work 7 years to get her hand in marriage. So he works his 7 years. But Uncle Laban, he's kind of in the cheating business, like Isaac, like Jacob is. And he cheats Jacob. And what happens is, on the marriage night, when he's supposed to have Rachel, he gives her Leah. And so then Jacob sleeps with Leah. It's dark. She's masked. There's some cultural things in there. He's like, whoa, what has happened? And then Laban's like, oh, I forgot to tell you. We got this little thing that we do where the older sister has to be married before the younger sister can be married. And you can have the younger sister too for another 7 years of work. But there's a really nice passage in the midst of this terrible story here that says that that Jacob loved Rachel. And so he works another 7 years, and it only seemed like a short while. And she becomes his wife. She's the wife that he loves. Now, he plays favoritism, and I understand why. He never wanted to marry Leah. He was cheated in that situation, but he does the honorable thing in the sense that he takes her and keeps her, and he cares for her, but he doesn't love her like a husband should love a wife. They're kind of, as I read this story, we would say it like this, they're just kind of roommates, because his real love is for Rachel. So, another thing about, and then between those, between Rachel and Leah, we're going to get the tribes of Israel. All the 12 sons are going to come from there. And so that's where you get, you know, Simeon and Reuben and Gad and Naphtali and all that. And there's just like this pregnancy war that breaks out between the two daughters. And not only the two daughters, but the handmaidens as well, because they're trying to one-up one another. And, you know, I don't know how Jacob had time to shepherd his flocks with all these kids they were having, but, you know, that's how the nation of Israel then is brought out. With that, I'll say this, though. So we have the sons that are born, that become the nation of Israel, but the son that really matters the most is the son Joseph. He matters most because he's the firstborn son to Rachel, who is the loved wife. And so that's the one he gravitates toward. This is my boy. This is my son. There's great joy because Rachel's the one that he loved. And Leah, what is interesting is, it's really a sad story. Leah is constantly trying to gain the love of Jacob. And she thinks that she'll gain the love by giving him a son. Oh, if I give him another son, then he'll love me. If I give him another son, then he'll love me. And there's just a really sad story of, he's never going to love her like she wants. And she really has a pretty sad life. And when you read the story about Rachel, she might have been the one that had the good looks, but I think her personality kind of stunk. Because when you kind of read through some of that, the way that she treats Leah in the midst of that, you know, she's all mad. And the way she treats Jacob, you know, why aren't you giving me a son? And Jacob's like, am I God? I'm not the one controlling, you know, how all this takes place. And she just, I mean, she might be pretty, but she sounds like a brat, if you ask me. Like, I don't know. But you can see some of those things within the story here. So there's a couple key verses there. I won't take time to read over all of those. You can read about those things. The other thing then that happens with Jacob is the wrestling with God. So there's a time when he's out in the wilderness, when he's, you know, been fleeing from Esau, and he wrestles with God, and there's a man that's wrestling with the angels, wrestling with him. It's the Lord wrestling with him, and he won't let go, and he touches his hip and wrenches his hip out of socket. And man, you got to know that hurt. And yet Jacob is holding on. He's like, I'm not going to let you go till you bless me. You done broke my hip. This ain't no good. Give me some blessing. You know, I mean, you can kind of read that story in there. And because of that, his name then is changed from Jacob to Israel, one who strives strives or struggles with God or wrestles with God. And that name is brought to the whole nation because the nation is constantly in this striving and struggling with God. Loving God, following God, and then falling away and going after the idols and the Baal worship and all the rest of that stuff. And there's this constant just wrestling with God. And we're like that too. I think you could call us Israel, you know, those we come to Christ. But Paul talked about it like this: the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, I do. And so there's this wrestling that we have with honoring God, and yet the sinful man inside us winning out sometimes. And so his name is changed there. Some other interesting things happened to Jacob, and there's a neat story in there, and I didn't intend to say so much about him, but when Esau finally comes out to meet Jacob, well, before that, there's Jacob. Jacob is like a con artist, and he's even trying to con God, which is kind of interesting because he makes this deal with God, like, if you will take me far away, and if you will bless me there, and if you will bring me back, then you'll be my God, and I'll follow you, and I'll, you know, give to you and all that. I mean, there's this if statement: God, you do all these things, then okay, I'll be good and I'll follow, you know. And we try to make that kind of deal with God today. You know, God, if you make this problem go away, if you make my finances increase, you know, expand my borders, prayer Jabez, let it all fall on me, God, you know, all those different things, then I'll honor you, and I'll come to church, and I'll be in Sunday school every Sunday, and, you know, I'll greet people at the door, and 3 weeks later, we don't even want to get out of bed because we're too lazy. It's Sunday morning. You know how it is? I mean, we make these deals with God, and Jacob's kind of like that, but he transforms as he goes through life. You see the con artist who gets conned and then kind of leaves his con artistry behind. So an interesting thing. So in the end, when Esau comes to meet him, Jacob divides his forces, his family and everything, and he does a real honorable thing. He puts his family on the other side of the ford, and he hangs out back here, and he waits to make sure that Esau doesn't kill everybody, because if they're going to get anyone, let them get all the kids and family and all that, and I'll be able to escape. And yeah, a real honorable guy. But when Esau does come to meet him, it's a moment of embracing, and he finds out that God has blessed Esau as well, and he has, you know, wealth, and he has servants and all that sort of stuff. And so this moment, Jacob kind of comes to he humbles himself a little bit, and it's sort of like he sort of throws himself at his brother's feet. He realizes, man, I've really done him wrong, and whatever happens, happens. And so you see this wonderful moment of grace being extended there. And he wants to give Esau a bunch of gifts and stuff like that. And Esau's like, no, God's already blessed me. And so great, great story there. All right, so then we come to Joseph here. Joseph is the second youngest son of Israel, right? Youngest son of Jacob. He's the first son that's born to Rachel. You know that she's going to have another son, Benjamin, and then she's going to die with complications of childbirth and that sort of stuff there. So he's the favorite of the sons. We have those wonderful stories about the cloak of many colors and a special cloak and that sort of thing there. He's treated special. The other brothers don't like him. And really, as you read the story, Joseph, it seems to be he's kind of the tattletale for dad, because it said that Joseph brought bad reports back on his brothers. Now, I've had two older brothers. Right? And if you got any siblings, you don't bring bad reports to your mom and dad about your other siblings if you sleep in the same room with your other siblings. You know what I'm saying? You don't say, well, Jim stole this and Ron broke that when they're in the same bed, because they beat you up at night. All right? Don't know how I know this, but I'm just telling you, don't tell reports on your brothers, because they're not so kind to you. They haven't learned that forgiveness grace thing yet, you know? And Joseph is kind of that way. And so he's bringing reports back to his brothers, and his dad is putting him in a position like that. So you could preach on that and teach on that. Like, parents, don't put one child against the other and make them tell me what your brothers are doing. Tell me what your sister said and those sorts of things there, because you put them in a really bad position. And so Joseph was in there. So Joseph goes out to check on his brothers. His brothers don't like him. They grab him. They rough him up a little bit. They want to kill him. I think it's Reuben that says, hey, you know, don't do this. Let's not shed the blood. He is our brother. You know, he's a jerk. I get it. We don't like him, but let's not kill him. And so he's thrown into a pit while they think about what they're going to do. And then they decide, hey, here come this caravan of Ishmaelites. Let's sell them. Let's sell him to slavery to the Ishmaelites. Now, where do you think the Ishmaelites come from? They come from the descendants of Ishmael. Now, how do you think those guys are going to feel when they get to get their hands on a distant cousin who was from the promised child when it should have been our papa, our granddaddy, who should have had that blessing? They were glad to have a descendant here. And I'm sure they didn't treat Joseph none too well as he was taken down. Yeah, we'll take him down to Egypt. We'll sell him into slavery. This is going to be awesome. And so there had to be a moment of glee within the Ishmaelite descendants there, feeling like, yeah, we've kind of got a little bit of vengeance here. And sometimes we miss that, but that's the problem when sin gets into our lives and we go our own way, like Abraham did. He could not have foreseen all how this was going to happen, but there are going to be problems. Even the descendants of Esau, when we get into Edom and how they are not going to like the Israelites when they want to go into the promised land and all the different stuff. I mean, this is like Desperate Housewives of the Old Testament. I mean, this is Hollywood stuff right here. This is reality TV stuff. You know what I'm saying? Just the way all this is put together. So he's sold then into slavery. He's taken down into Egypt. You know, when he goes down into Egypt, he's in Potiphar's house. God blesses him there. He's put into a situation where Potiphar's wife is trying to seduce him, and Joseph flees, leaving his cloak there. She screams. She lies. Potiphar's angry. He's thrown in jail. While he's in jail, the Bible says that God was with him, and now he is elevated, and the warden is like, hey, this guy's, you know, doing good. God's watching over him, and he becomes in charge of the prison there. And while he's there, he has this ability to understand and interpret dreams. And so he interprets a dream about the cupbearer and the baker who are in there because they can't figure out their dreams. And so Joseph interprets the dream there. You know that eventually the baker dies. The cupbearer is restored back to service with Pharaoh. And Joseph says, hey, remember me when you get back up, to Pharaoh. And he, like anybody in jail, forgets the promises that he made in jail. And so then some time breaks out. Pharaoh has a dream, can't figure it out. His magicians can't figure it out. The cupbearer suddenly remembers about Joseph. Joseph is brought up. He answers the dream about 7 years of great plenty and 7 years of famine. And then Joseph basically institutes a 20% tax. Take 1/5 of the grain harvest and all of that and store that away. And because he's able to do that, he's placed in second in charge of Egypt. So you got Pharaoh and then you have Joseph. And so because of his position there, then he's elevated. And then great stuff about the story there when his brothers come back, when the famine hits. After a while, there's no grain anywhere, and everyone goes down to Egypt to get bread. And the reason they go to Egypt is because the flowing of the Nile. In the Nile Delta, even in a famine, you know, the Nile is still flowing, flows lower, and you can get some food there. So that's why everyone's going down to Egypt. So they come down to Egypt, and you know the story how the brothers come down, and Joseph recognizes them, but they don't recognize him because he's probably all dolled up with, like we see with Egyptians, haircut certain ways, the eye paint and all that kind of stuff. And so he's blending in now with an Egyptian culture, but they're still Asiatic and Canaanite, you know, so he's like, he sees them and he recognizes them. They don't recognize him. You know how it goes back and forth. He wants to see his brother Benjamin because they tell him he got a brother and all that story. Eventually, Jacob relents and lets Benjamin go because he holds one of the other brothers. He holds Judah, I think it is. And so long story short, Joseph reveals himself to his brothers and they are fearful. And this is a great, great passage of the Bible. I have used it to preach for bad things that have happened to me in church settings. And Joseph said this. He said to his brothers, he said, you intended for this to be harmful to me, but God intended for this to be good. And there are things that have happened. I've used that sermon, to preach a sermon of the things that I that people intended to be harmful, that God intended to be good. And I used it especially when I went to India and was talking with Jay Henry. And I'll tell you the quick story of why. Because when I was in New Richmond, where I grew up, I got baptized when I was 12, and J. Henry used to come to our house all the time. He'd come to our church, and he'd preach. And Jay's kids, you know, Nimretta, his daughter, and Simeon, Nimretta, Simeon, and Mark, his son passed away like when he was 12 or 13 with a heart condition. I remember him because he's a little toddler baby and had problems. But the girls would come over, and my mom was like, oh yeah, bring them girls over. They'd hang out because they were closer age with my brother. Well, I mean, 12, 13, 14-year-old teenagers who don't know each other, don't like to get along, especially when they can't speak English very well and we can't speak Hindi. So it was like a bad junior high date. We're on one side of the room, they're on the other side of the room. There's the two Indian girls, here's three little white boys over here. And we learned to get along with one another, and we kind of play with, so they would always come over. And they would come over because my mom, we'd always buy like a whole cow each year because the three of us, we ate a lot of food. And Jay, he loved cow because he's like, I don't get holy cow in India. So he'd come over to our house so he could have holy cow. We'd always make steaks for him and stuff, you know, because they don't kill cows in India, you know, because they're sacred. You know, they're sacred to us too, with A1 sauce on there. But anyway, so I got to know him, and then some time went by, you know, I was in the military, blah, 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 and came back, there's a little church in Glencoe, and then that didn't work, and then went to the church in Highland, and I was trying to get Jay on in our missions there and try to do something with him, but they were real standoffish with doing that. They didn't want to take on anybody else, and so I started building a relationship with him again once I was preaching, and I would go to the North American, our Christian convention, annual Christian convention, and I would see Jay, and so I would keep that relationship up with him and all. And then things got real bad there. And finally I resigned from that church there and was about ready to walk out of the ministry altogether and got the call to come here. And then came down here and then there's... It's wonderful ever since. Yeah, that's how I write my memoirs. So anyway, came down here, and it took several years, but when we did some revamping of our missions activities, and we were looking at who we were going to do missions work with, and one of the things that we wanted to change was having a personal contact with the missionaries, because some of the missionaries that we'd had for a long time weren't contacting us anymore. They were coming, some of them were retiring, coming out of the field. So it was a good time to just kind of change some of that up. And in the midst of that, I talked about, hey, you know, Jay's been down here and interesting. So we did, we decided to take on the work that's going over in India. And then I had the chance to go over there. And so I told them the story that I was so angry how things ended in my church in Kentucky and like all of that. And I think there were some people who intended for a lot of bad to happen to me. You know, they just wanted me gone. Some of them did. Most of the church didn't, but there was a few that did. And I said, you know, I don't think they had any good reasoning for some of that. But what they intended for good, for bad, God used for good, because it allowed me to be in a place at the right time where we could then be supportive of Jay. And now we've been to India with a mission team twice, and he's coming again in July, and hopefully we're going to send another team with him to keep up that relationship with him. So a great, great passage of the Bible that can be used in stories in your life, wherever someone has done something that you sort of felt like, man, they just tried to wrong me. God can use that wrong to do something good. You know, that's why Paul says that God works out all things for the good of those who love and trust in him. And so even when bad things happen to you, he can still bring out good. All right, that's enough preaching, right? I wasn't here to preach on it, but sometimes I just can't help myself. You know what I'm saying? All right. Let's move on then to the story of Exodus. Love this story. Love a lot of stuff that's going on in here. So many neat things about the history of Egypt and the pharaohs and Moses and where all that falls in timeline and all kinds of neat things here. So let me give you a couple of the fill-ins here just to kind of get information. The book of Exodus is about the bondage of the descendants of Jacob in the land of Egypt. So when Joseph goes down to Egypt, eventually he brings his whole family down to Egypt to survive the famine, and they don't leave Egypt. They stay there. And it says they settled in Goshen, and they began to increase over there. Exodus means the outgoing. So when we talk about Exodus, it's the outgoing from Egypt, going into the promised land, the leaving there. The book is broken down into three major sections there. The first one is the Exodus. In chapters 1 through 18, it describes the power of God that's displayed through the plagues. that caused Pharaoh eventually to let the people leave the land. And we've seen all those, and we've seen the movies of the Ten Commandments and all that kind of stuff. And could anyone have played that better than, was it Yul Brynner and Charlton Heston? You know, they played just like, you know, who is this God of the Hebrews that I should let these people go? And then, you know, Charlton Heston is like, do not smite God, Pharaoh. He, you know, I mean, just great stuff, you know. And you watch this week, Ten Commandments is going to be on because they always play the Ten Commandments at Easter. It has nothing to do with Easter, but they think, hey, it's a Bible story. Put it on. You know, TV producers, they don't know anything. It's like, put on the Passion of the Christ. Something like that deals with Jesus, crucifixion, resurrection. No, we'll put on Ten Commandments. I'm like, okay. Precursor, the law, that's why we needed the Savior. But hey, you know, whatever. They got a little God on TV there, and they felt good about themselves. So we have the Exodus. Then the next thing is the law. The law that's given, the law of God. You can think about the Ten Commandments and all the other laws, stuff that comes down from Mount Sinai. And then we have the tabernacle as the next major issue in there, and that's chapters 25 through 40. The plans that are given by God for the forming of the tent of meeting. And eventually it's going to be in the temple, the actual building that Solomon is going to build, the structure where they, in their mind, see the presence of God in that building. But we know that God doesn't reside within buildings of stone and wood. Then we have the enslavement that takes place. The Bible talks about that there was a new Pharaoh who came to power who did not know Joseph and all that he had done to save Egypt from the famine. We so quickly forget history. We do that now. You think about the people even just a couple hundred years ago who did great things that brought freedom to our nation through the Revolutionary War and all those different things, or those who sacrificed through the Civil War and all that. We don't remember most of these people or anything that they did, and we forget. And they say if you forget history, you're doomed to repeat it, right? And that kind of thing there. Well, the same is true even in these ancient times. Joseph did some great things. But after a while, people become complacent. New Pharaoh comes, doesn't know, doesn't even remember what Joseph did or all the good things and that sort of stuff. So there's no care and concern then for the descendants of Joseph. So then the Bible talks about how the Egyptians, how they feared the Hebrews, that they were going to join the enemies of the Egyptians. And some think that what they're talking about is the Hyksos, which was another kind of group of people around that time that fought with the Egyptians, and they were afraid they were going to ally together. The Hyksos actually kind of controlled Egypt for a while, and you can read back on Egyptian history a little bit about that. So we're not exactly sure who these things are, but we know that they were afraid that we're going to be outnumbered, and if they side with whoever they were considering their enemies at that time, they're going to overpower us. So what they do then is they're going to enslave them. When they try to oppress the people, they also try to suppress the birth rate. So they want to kill the baby boys, and the midwives are told to do that. But the midwives honor God, they fear God, and they don't obey Pharaoh. And God blesses these midwives with children of their own. And then when that doesn't work out, then it's like, okay, we take these baby boys and we throw them in the Nile, which many people think what that is referring to is probably some pagan worship as well, as not only just kind of trying to kill off the population growth, but also in worship, because they would worship the crocodile as one of the gods of the many gods that the Egyptians would worship and venerate and those kind of things there. So a whole terrible thing that is happening in the midst of all that. Exodus 1 verse 8 talks about that new king who didn't know about Joseph. Then it talks about Pharaoh's order there. You can see in 22 that the boys are thrown into the Nile, but let the girls live. In the midst of that time, while all that's going on, then we have Moses. First thing we got to say about Moses is Moses has a special birth, a special situation, significance that's kind of taking place there. He's born to a Levite family. The names are in there, Amram and Yochebed, his wife. Moses is hid for 3 months. You know, they don't want him to be sacrificed. They hide him for 3 months. You know the story. He's placed in the basket, and he's set among the reeds of the Nile where Pharaoh's daughter comes to bathe. Now, if you've seen the cartoon of, what is it, Prince of Egypt or something like that, DreamWorks cartoon that was done on there, it kind of shows like they just put the basket out there and whoo, the basket went floating. It just happened to come where Pharaoh's daughter was. That's not how this works. Miriam and Joseph and Jochebed, they are paying attention to what's going on. And they placed him among you. They placed him where they knew Pharaoh's daughter would come, where Moses would be found. And Miriam she's posted to watch there. So while Jochebed's got to go back and do her duties, whatever those are, the chores and slave work that she has to do, her daughter, Miriam, Moses' sister, is there. She's watching what's going on. I'm not just letting this baby be out there on the Nile. There's bad things in the Nile, crocodiles in the Nile, snakes in the Nile, things I do not like, which is why I didn't want to go be a missionary over in that area, you know? I don't like snakes and alligators, and God brought me to Florida where we got snakes and alligators, so... Tell God what you're not going to do and then sit back and laugh because he's gonna send you somewhere. So while there, right, you know, Pharaoh's daughter comes down, finds him, brings him up out of the water, and that's where his name comes from, Hermosus, drawn from the water. And Miriam then comes and says, hey, shall I go get one of the Hebrew midwives to care for the baby? Yes, she goes and gets Mama. Moses' mother then is able to care for Moses when he's a little child, and then at a certain age after he's weaned, then he's turned over to Pharaoh's daughter, and then he's raised in the house of royalty. He's raised under Pharaoh there. After he's in there for a while, then the next thing that happens to him is that Moses is going to have a fleeing to Midian. He will flee to Midian. What happens is Moses starts to see the inhumane treatment that's happening to his people. He's recognizing that he is a Hebrew like they are, and so he sees their suffering. He really gets upset when he sees an Egyptian taskmaster beating a Hebrew slave. He gets mad. He ends up killing the Hebrew taskmaster. Thinks this is going to be good to some degree. His people are going to like him, but then they're like, oh, you killed that guy. You're going to kill us too? We know what's going on. And it sort of backfires on him. Pharaoh then wants to kill Moses at this point. Kind of interesting. Some people think this is Tutmosis III, who's the Pharaoh who wants to kill Moses. And so Moses then flees in the desert to Midian for safety. When he goes out there, he meets Reuel, who is the high priest of Midian, and then he marries his daughter, Zipporah, and then he becomes a shepherd. And he's out there in the fields for about 40 years. So 40 years in Egypt, 40 years as a shepherd, and 40 years doing what God's called him to do. So when you're 80 years old, just realize God's getting ready to call you to do something really big, okay? So you're not out of the woods yet. You can't retire. You can't say, I'm almost done. You're getting ready to go in the third stretch of life, right? Nobody's going, yay! Yeah, I know some of you are like all worn out and worn down and tired. Well, tell God your plans and then sit back and laugh. So there's a verse there about just when he wanted to kill him. These were some key verses here. The next thing that happens in Moses' life then is the call of God. The call of God. Moses is out there just doing his thing, shepherding his flock, and he notices the bush that is burning. And it's not being consumed. It's kind of cool in the movie and the TV, you know. I must go see this light that burns in the bush doesn't consume. You know, I can't do Charlton Heston. I look as good as him, I know. I don't have the voice, you know. It's the voice is the problem. It's not the looks, you know. Yeah, whatever. So anyway, he goes off to see the bush there, right? God tells him, remove your sandals. You know, Moses, remove your sandals. You're on holy ground. Take your shoes off. Right? And that in that moment there, that's when there's that interaction that takes place, and Moses wants to know who this is, and who shall I say is sending me, and that's where we get the I am statement. God says, I am, that I am, you know, it would be translated, the one that exists, or I will be what I will be. It really means the existing one. And it's the one name that God gives, you know, for himself, that how do we address him? He is the existing one. We talked about this last week a little bit at the beginning, that the origin of God is not described in the book of Genesis. It's the only thing, when you go through the origin, it's not the only thing in the origin, because, you know, like dinosaurs and stuff aren't directly talked about in there, although when we talked about creating land animals, I think that was in that statement. But it just doesn't give the origin of God. It just begins with the affirmation that God exists. In the beginning, God created heavens and the earth, you know, and starts from that point there. So God is the existing one here. And then he sends Moses to Pharaoh along with Aaron, his brother, to be the mouthpiece there. And it's a great, great story where God says, I want you to go do this. And Moses has this interaction. But God, I can't speak. And what am I going to say to them? And what if they ask? And he's just going back and forth. But finally, after Moses runs out of excuses, he basically just says, God, just send somebody else. I just don't want to go. I mean, we do this too, do we not? We're like, I can't teach, so I don't want to get up in front of people, and I can't sing, and I'm real nervous, and I can't do this. And I just get somebody else, God, because really I'm too lazy to serve you. I mean, you might as well just say it what it is, because sometimes that's how it comes down. We have all these excuses, but it comes down to this. I just don't want to do it. And when he says, just send somebody else, then it says, God's anger burned against Moses. And I think at that point, Moses is like, oh, I said too much. Okay, God. I'll do what you want. You win. But Moses then relents there, and he obeys God, and Aaron is sent to be the mouthpiece to speak for him. And they go to Pharaoh, right, and they demand, let my people go. And you know that whole story there. A couple key verses there about taking off your sandals and the I am statement. That's what we call the Tetragrammaton, the four consonants, because I've said this, shared this with you before, but the Hebrew language does not have vowels. It has consonants, and probably right around the time when they went to the Babylonian captivity, they put vowel markings so that they would not lose how a word was pronounced, what vowel sound was there. So there are vowel markings that tell you whether it's what vowel it is, and whether that vowel is a long A, a long O, short O, that kind of thing there. And so we're not exactly sure how some of these words are pronounced. We're not even sure exactly how the word Yahweh is pronounced, but that's probably the closest. The way we get that understanding is by taking the Hebrew and then looking in the Septuagint, because we know the Greek words, and the Greeks love vowels. They had vowels everywhere. Too many vowels in their words. And by understanding that and knowing the Hebrew consonants, that's where we kind of come up with some of our pronunciation of some of the Hebrew words, because we didn't have the language. They didn't know exactly how that was done. So that I am there is the word where the Hebrews, the Jews, the Israelites, however you want to call them, they would not say the name of God. They wouldn't say this word for fear that they would be misusing the name of God. So they would just refer there, the four consonants, and then they would go on. You know, it was sort of like for a while there when Prince he didn't use his name. He was the symbol. Then he was the artist. And you know, you're like, you know what I'm saying? So kind of that sort of idea there. So, okay, so his name there, he sends in. Let's come down then to 6 there on the Exodus. God sends the 10 plagues on the Egyptians because of the stubborn heart of Pharaoh. It's interesting in here because it says that God hardened Pharaoh's heart. And that has really bothered some people, because they're like, God hardened his heart, and then, you know, God's going to do these bad things. But I think God hardened his heart in the sense of this. God knew if he made this move, Pharaoh would make this move. And if I do this, Pharaoh will do that. And I think that that's really what he's talking about when God said, okay, I know the moves you're going to make, and you want to go down this road of being disobedient and hard-hearted and all that? Okay, I'll do the chess moves. If I want to make my wife upset, I know how to do it. You're laughing. Do you know how to make my wife upset too? You know how to make her upset. You know what buttons to push. You know what words to say. You know what things to do. Like if I want to have a fight tonight, I say this. She's going to do that. And then I'm going to go, doot, 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 checkmate. We got a big fight going on. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. You've hardened the heart of your spouse. I know you have. So if I come in upset one day, just so you just know, Michelle hardened Steve's heart, you know. And so it's usually the other way around. She's controlling the video, so she might edit this out. I'm not sure. But nonetheless, they all know the truth. I know it. They know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. You just guys have no idea what I go through. I know it. I know it. I speak of the truth in God's house. Anyway, let me. It's bad because this stuff's on tape now. I get away with this because it's not on tape, but it'll be out there for all to see. Let me go through the things that happened. The first thing is the Nile was turned into blood. And then it says that Pharaoh's magicians were able to copy that. And some think that really what they were probably able to do is to stir up the sediment and stuff that was in the Nile there, that like the iron content and things that would give it like a reddish haze. And I don't personally think it's like any demonic thing that they're doing at this point. I think they've kind of figured out through sleight of hand, that kind of stuff, that we can mimic the things of God. So they kind of mimic that. Same thing with the frogs. They can do some things. They know they do some stuff that can draw the frogs up out of there. I mean, if you leave dead fish around, you're going to draw flies and different stuff. And you can go, oh, look, we made flies. That kind of stuff takes place. But by the time we get to the third one with the gnats, the magicians say, this is the finger of God. The magicians are saying, wait a minute. We pulled out all the stops. We could only do two. This one's got God's finger on it, and it just keeps going from there. We get the flies that happen in number four. Number five, the Egyptian livestock is going to die. In number six, you're going to get the boils. Then you're going to get the hail. Then you're going to get, in number eight, the locusts. Then you're going to get the darkness for 3 days. And then you're going to get the death of the firstborn male. That brings us then to the Passover night there. And I talked about this just in our Sunday morning, I guess, a couple weeks ago, about the whole Lamb of God thing that was spoken and where that idea came from. And it comes from this moment here when God tells them, okay, bad thing's going to happen. Come strike down the firstborn in every household. And he wasn't going to differentiate between anybody, Hebrews or Egypt, I'm striking the firstborn. But this is how I will pass over your house. And they would kill the lamb. The blood was put on the doorpost and over the lintel. And when God would see the blood there, he would pass over that house. Death would pass over that house. And that child would survive and would go to the next house where he did not see the blood there. And he would strike down and take the firstborn there. And so there's a the wailing that takes place in Egypt. When that happens, Pharaoh then finally concedes and he releases the Hebrews after this last plague. As they're leaving, it says that the Egyptians gave them things, gave them gold and silver and linen and said, take this and get out of here. And that's how they're going to build the tent of meeting with all of those things. So as they're leaving, Pharaoh has a change of mind because he's angry and he's vengeful. And God's hardening his heart, and God knows this guy isn't going to relent. And when he takes his own child, then he goes and he pursues after them. And then you know the story, how God parts the waters to allow the Israelites to pass because they're being pinched on one side by the approaching army of Egypt. And then the water that is before them, and through Moses, God will part the waters. They walk across on dry land. And then when the army comes to pursue them, then God causes the waters to come back over and consume the army of Egypt. And so, terrible thing happens there. Now they're brought over into the wilderness. Several things that happen while they're out in the wilderness there. One is that God's going to provide water from the rock. You know, they're out there, and oh, you've brought us out here to die. They need water out there. God's going to provide for them. The story is God providing constantly, and the people complaining constantly. Kind of a lot like us today. God provides, we complain. God, I need a car. And then he gives you a car, and you go, I need a better car. God, I need a house. He gives you a house. I want a third bedroom. God, I need a job. He gives me a job. I don't like working here. You know, there's all these things. We constantly have that issue. Whatever God gives us, it's not enough. God provides them manna and quail to eat, but it was only good for that day. which taught them to rely on God. And only one day, the day of preparation, could they take in a double portion, so that on the Sabbath when they were resting, they weren't out collecting food. But if they held anything more than that day, it would go bad. So it taught them to rely on God daily, which Jesus brings in when he says, give us this day our daily bread. And we don't really understand that very much in our Western culture, because at any given moment, most of us have at least a couple days of food in our pantry. We recognize this over in India, where if they didn't sell some fish that day, they didn't have any money to eat that night. If they didn't sell something at the market. I mean, when they had those prayers in many of those areas that we were at, especially in the poorer village areas, I mean, they recognized when they prayed, God, give me daily subsistence, it was daily subsistence. And God was teaching them, you trust in me daily. And we lose that. And I think that's why we don't trust in God so much, because we trust in our bank accounts, we trust in our storehouses, we trust in all these other things instead of trusting daily in God. And we've learned not to trust in God. And then when life takes a turn and there's things that we cannot control, then suddenly it's like, oh God, I trust you, please. And God's like, oh really? You know? So we got to learn to trust in him daily. So the manna issue there. I lost where I was in my notes there. Oh, and point C here. Then God gives the law on Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments here. So you can find these in Exodus chapter 20 in your Bible. But the first one is right, no other gods. Have no other gods before me. And he does that because they've come out of a culture where there was dozens of gods. You know, and even Pharaoh saw himself as a god. And so God is, true God, God Yahweh, the I Am, is saying, there's no one else before me. I don't want anything else in your life. No other God, no other worship, no other idol, nothing else in your life. And we don't think that we have any other gods in America. We think we don't have paganism or idol worship in America sometimes, because we're not bowing down to statues of stone and things like that, which was real obvious when we went to India and watched people in the Hindu temple bow down to the little stone carved god behind a gate of iron and all this being protected. And there was, you know, I mean, they have millions of gods, but within there, they probably had, I don't know, 30 or 40 major gods within this one temple complex. And they were burning off incense and smoke and banging these clanging things. It was driving us nuts. And they just ding, ding. I mean, it was like that monkey. Ding, 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 ding. It just kept going on and on and on. And I'm like, man, and watch people come down and kiss this nasty floor and leave food there for a god that's not going to eat it. And just, I'm thinking, how can they do that? And we come over here and we go down to the god of JCPenney's and the god of Sears and my favorite god, the god of Craftsman Tools. And, you know, and we don't see it, but we're doing the same thing as placing those things above the god that we should be worshiping. We don't see that. But other cultures see our God as materialism and how that works its way into the church. We become blinded to that. And they're not blinded to that, but they're kind of blinded sometimes to their God of paganism. And so, anyway, the point is, don't have any other gods. God says, no other gods. Doesn't matter what you worship, whether it be an idol or money or power or whatever. And then no idols, right? Nothing to take that place. Nothing that causes you to draw yourself to that. And I see I'm real close on time. Let me just tell you what these are. I won't even talk about them. But number three then is, don't misuse the name of the Lord. Number four is to remember the Sabbath. Remember the day of rest that God has given you. Great thing there. Jesus talks about it, that the Sabbath wasn't, a man was not made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for man. God gave us that day because we needed it. It's not that it's not the other way around. Number five, honor your parents. The first commandment with a promise, honor your parents, that it will go well with you. Sometimes very challenging to do. Number six, do not murder. And you really want to write the word murder there, not kill. When we talk the word thou shalt not kill, we get in all kinds of theological problems, and that's not what it says, but it says thou shalt do no murder, and there's a difference between killing and murder. And then it says do not commit adultery. Why? Because God wanted a one man, one woman committed relationship from the beginning, and he knew when you go outside of that, it is always, always bad. Do not steal. It's the idea of, if it's not yours, don't take it. God wants us to learn to be content. Do not lie or do not bear false witness. The idea is be honest. God is honest and true, and there's nothing that is false in him, the scripture says. And when we lie, the Bible tells us, you are like your father, the devil, who is the father of lies. And number 10 is do not covet. Because when we covet, when we want something that somebody else has, it'll draw us into all these other things. It'll cause us to lie so that we can get ahead. It might cause us to steal so that we can have what we want. We might covet another person's wife or another person's husband and then fall into adultery. That might lead to murder. Oh, we saw that with someone. Oh, that's right, David. And so then we have then, that just tumbles down the line. If we act that way, are we dishonoring our parents? Absolutely, if they trained us and taught us to be different than that. And then once we break those things, it's easy to have idols. It's easy to misuse the name of the Lord. It's easy to forget God. All the rest starts falling apart as well. So there's the key verses there in Exodus chapter 20 and following. Next week when we come back, we're going to talk about the tabernacle and some very, very neat things that are in the tabernacle. And I want to show you the an analogy of the items that are in the tabernacle to the church and how the tabernacle brought people into the presence of God and things that are in the church that are kind of representative of one another. It's real interesting. Had a professor show me that, and I've always enjoyed it, and so we'll do that next week. So, guys, thank you for being here tonight. Let us close this out with a word of prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for being able to come together as believers and to just kind of skim through right now the wonderful stories that have been laid down in Scripture that remind us of who you are and tell us of how you've interacted with man and examples of how man has rejected your ways and rejected your laws. Father, we can look at those stories and we can learn from them of what not to do. And then we can look at stories where we see people who did honorable things like Joseph, who fled temptation and who was trusting in you. And even when bad things happened, he trusted that you would bring those things to a good end. Father, be with us as we leave here tonight. May we be the hands and feet of Jesus in our community until Jesus comes again or he calls us home. In his name we pray. Amen.